Friends, today we will discuss what third part of your solution center. Vapor pressure of a liquid solution. As we have already discussed that in a liquid solution, always the solvent become liquid. So in a liquid solution is formed when solvent is liquid, but solute may be gas, may be liquid, may be solid. Liquid is a volatile, but solute may or may not be volatile. Thus, the vapor pressure will be discussing only in liquid-liquid solution or solid-in-liquid solution. Now let us see about the vapor pressure of liquid-liquid solution. Let us take two volatile liquid, that is liquid 1 and liquid 2. If we took together in a closed vessel, and then during the time both the liquids, that is liquid 1 and liquid 2, will evaporate their own vapor pressures, and thus the total vapor pressure is the contribution of vapor pressure of first one, that is what P1, and vapor pressure of second one, that is what P2, at equilibrium between the liquid and the vapor gas. The total vapor pressure above the liquid mixture is P total. That is, now you added this one and this one, then you get P total. The vapor pressure are related to the mole fraction of X1 and X2 of the component 1, 2. As P1 is directly proportional to X1 and P2 is directly proportional to X2. Now let us see the another part. That is round screw. Round screw we can classify, or we can divide into two ways. First one is round screw for the volatile solute, another one is the non-volatile. Generally we use the volatile one. Say we have a round screw of AOUL Rawls law. We have Rawls law. Rawls law for a volatile liquid. You can say Rawls law for a volatile liquid. Number one. Step S. Then Rawls law we can express as the partial vapor pressure of this component. The partial vapor pressure of its components, the percent vapor pressure of its component of the solution of the solution is directly proportional to the mole fraction. The mole fraction present in the solution. Mole fraction present in solution. So for component one, we have P1, P1 is directly proportional to X1. That is P1 is equal to P0 1 X1, where P0 1 is the vapor pressure of your components 1. Okay. P0 1 is the vapor pressure of your component 1. Your component 1 at the same temperature. At the same temperature. Similarly, for the components 2, again P2 is directly proportional to X2, so P2 equal to P02 and X2. So we can write as for component 2, again for component 2, again for component 2, this become P2, this become X2, P2 is equal to P02 X2, component 2 at the same temperature, like this. Again, for component 2, we have P2 is directly proportional to X2, P2 equal to P02 and X, here X2, P02 and X2, where P02 is the vapor pressure of the pure component 2 at the same temperature. Now, if we apply Dalton's laws of partial pressure, Dalton's laws of partial pressure, partial pressure. According to this law, we know that the sum of the partial pressures give the pressure about the liquid. The pressure about the liquid. That is, if we apply this, we got P total, that is the sum of the pressure about the liquid. This is equal to P1 plus P2, that is partial pressure. That is what pressure exerted by the first liquid plus pressure exerted by the second liquid. Substituting the value of P1 and P2. Then we got P0 1 X1 plus P0 2 X2. Now you substitute this one and you substitute this one. P total equal to this. Now X1, as we know that some of the mole fractions is always unity. So there is, we know X1 plus X2 equal to 1, we know this one. So if you try to find out X1, then 1 minus X2. So 1 minus X2, P0 1, this is equal to P0 plus P0 2 X2 we have. Now, here, if we multiply this one to here, then P0 1 minus P0 1 X2 plus P0 2 X2. Now, if the common one, that is, say X2, if we have taken, then P0 2 minus P0 1 X2. We got this equation. That is P total equal to P0 1 plus P0 2 minus P0 1 X2. Now, from this we can conclude as the total vapor pressure. So we can conclude as total vapor pressure of the solution or over the solution, over the solution, the total vapor pressure over the solution can be related to the mole fraction of any one of the components. Can be related to the mole fraction of any one of the components. That is what you get in the last question. We got one of X2. Here it is not X1, only X2. So X2 is our question of second component. So you can convert into one also. So like this, this is what our first conclusion. Then second conclusion, the total vapor pressure. The total vapor pressure over the solution, whereas mole fraction. That is linearly with mole fraction of the component 2 of the component 2. So this is what we get it, and this will get after drawing the graph of vapor process versus mole fraction for the equation P total equal to P naught 1 plus P naught 2 minus P naught 1 X2. Now let us take or let us see the graph. Here we have drawn vapor pressure and here let us see mole fraction. Mole fraction X or X2 we can say for the segment. Here or here X1 we will take 2 ending. Here in the first ending X1 and X2. This is here also X1, X2. Here if we have taken only X1, X2 become 0 as sum is 1, and here if you have taken X2 that will become like this one. So now we have two end. The first one is here, that is P naught 1, and we have another end is here. So we can put another end is here, P naught 2. So now let us join this one. Linearly you will get it. Now let us join this formula. P2 will get linearly. This is for P1. P1 means first equation, that is P1. Now P2 means second equation, that is P2. Now P2 total should be the linear vector of this 2, that is, and this is P2. P2, or that is what? P total. P total equal to P1 plus P2. Now we got three equations. This is equation 1. This is equation 2, this is what? Equation 3. Which we have over here? P1 is directly proportional to X1, this graph shows that, and P2 is directly proportional to X2, this graph shows that, and the third equation, that is P2 to P1 plus P2, this equation graph is like this one. So all this what you call linear vector of mole fraction. Here we know. Now, point number 3. Let us discuss point number 3. The depending on the vapor pressure of the pure components 1 and 2, depending on the pure component 1 and 2, the total vapor pressure over the solution, the total vapor pressure over the solution decrease or increase? Decrease or increase? Will increase in the water fraction? So if we increase component 1 mole fraction, then sum, that is one of X2, gradually decreases. If X2 is decreased, then automatically gradually decreases. That means it gradually decreases, means if X2 is decreased, then in the graph we have L by this one. So X2 means, if X2 decreases, means it comes to this side. Suppose if here to here, if you come in this graph, this is for this one. Here, x1 is, as we already know that x1 is 1, x2 is 0. So, let us see 2 points here. Here, the vapor pressure goes like this one. So, all we have here is that from here to here, if you decrease, then automatically the vapor pressure gradually drops down. So, this is what we have seen in the point number 3. Now let us take the plot of P1 or P2 versus the mole fraction X1 and X2. Then we have seen the two linear equation. This one is the P1 and this one is the P2. This you have already seen all. So if the compositions of the vapor press, that is one of, are in equilibrium with the solution, then partial pressure can be determined by the using the another formula, that is one of, if y1 and y2, instead of x we have given y1 and y2 are the more flexible in vapor phase, okay. More flexible of the component 1 and 2 in vapor phase, then for component 1 we have P1, this is equal to, or this is directly proportional to y1. So y1 means we have y1, if it comes to equality, then we will get y1, this, that is one of, we can say P total, we will write this like this one. And if P2 is there, we can write as y2 P total. So this equation is used only in case of vapor components only. in case of upper components, as we already know that both the two components can contribute in the vapor phase. Thus, the vapor pressure will gradually increases in this case. So, like this, we can express the vapor pressure of a liquid solution. Now, let us see some more in your chapter. Now this we call as this raw flow we also call as raw flow in case of vapor components. We also call as Carnot flow. We also call as Carnot flow. We also call as Carnot rule. According to this rule, at a fixed temperature, the vapor phase is always richer. The vapor phase is always richer in more volatile component. More volatile component as compared to the solution now, that is in the solute-solvent interaction is there, which reduces the amount. Thereby, the vapor phase is always richer in water component as compared to the solution phase. In other words, you can say more fraction of more volatile components. More fraction of the more volatile component is always greater. In the vapor phase than in the solution phase. This is the definition of Carnot rule. Now this can be expressed by the formula is which we already discussed, that is E1 equal to Y1 E total. This is what we have. We are going to Carnot rule. Now we will go to the ideal solution. Before going to ideal solution, let us see raw flow as well as raw flow as a special case of analysis. As we know that in case of Raoult's law, we have now P is directly proportional to percent vapor pressure with mole fraction, and same thing like this, we have P means total pressure, this pressure for first component is, let us take the first component P1, equal to, we have P01 X1. So, something like this, in case of this P1 equal to KI X1, this is what we have in case of your energy score. So, here, what is the similarity? Pressure, vapor pressure is the same, and so this one and this one, mole percent is the same. Then what is the difference? These two. Then this, oh no, if the vapor pressure of the pure components is equal to this, that is constant, then both equations become equal. So we can conclude as if the value of partial vapor pressure is equal to and that is constant. Then both Raoult's law, and Mohs law confirm, and Mohs law become equivalent. Again, we can explain this. What is Henry's law? We can explain this is the pressure produced by the components when the mole fraction of the substance become unity. So, case we can explain, you take one this one, you take one this one, then K is equal to this. So, that is what? It is the, this Henry's constant is the vapor pressure of the component when the concentration of one mole or the molarity. Concentration of the gate. Components is of one molarity. Then equivalence inner is constant. Now we go to the ideal solution. Vapor pressure of the solution of solid in input. We can discuss the solution. After then, we go to the your ideal solution. Here, as we know that if we put a volatile solid, to a solution, automatically vapor here, so let us say liquid molecules here, liquid molecule can incorporate as a gas. Now let us put another your solute molecules here. Solute is the this volatile solute. So among this we have, this is your solute, this is your solvent. So if you put some volatile solute, Volatile solvent also can contribute some pressure, and this solvent also can contribute pressure. So the pressure produced by this solution is always have higher vapor pressure than the pure components. Now this is what we S. We know that P2 is equal to P1 plus P2. That is here this P total. This is equal to P1 plus P2. So if you have taken P1 only, then the total pressure is only for P1. If you have taken P2 also, as P2 is volatile, volatile means if it is, if this also keep some more pressure, so P total pressure will increase. This is what in case of volatile. But if you have taken non-volatile solute, if you have taken non-volatile solute, then if you have taken non-volatile solute, then you can observe this. As we have already seen that if it is pure solvent, the molecules in the upper layer of the volatile liquid can easily escape as a vapor. So it is in the vapor phase. Here we have seen three molecules are in the vapor phase. But when we put non-volatile solute, this is what? Non-volatile. This is non-volatile. Now, if you put non-volatile solute, there is a force of attraction between the non-volatile solute and volatile solvent. Thus, least number of solvent molecules will go in the vapor phase. So, automatically, there is three. If it is in the solution, only one atom goes as a vapor. So, like this one, gradually, vapor pressure gradually decreases if we added a non-volatile solute. So we can compare, if we add a non-volatile solute, then automatically vapor pressure of the solution gradually decreases than the pure solvent. So this is, so here we have seen that one there is a two different cases. First one, if it is a volatile, then gradually it increases the vapor pressure. And another one, if it is non-volatile, it gradually decreases the vapor pressure. So Rostow we can modify in the form of general way, yes. That means general Rostow. We can say general form of Rostow. Form of Rostow. We can say if for any solution, for any solution. For any solution means it may be liquid solution, it may be solid liquid solution, it may be volatile, it may be non-volatile. The partial vapor pressure, the partial vapor pressure, the partial vapor pressure, the partial vapor pressure of its volatile component. Volatile component, the partial vapor pressure of its volatile component in the solution is directly proportional to in the solution is directly proportional to proportional to its mole fraction. Its mole fraction. This is the general definition of our Rawls law. Now, let us see about ideal and non-ideal solution. Let us see about ideal and non-ideal solution. Those solutions which obey Rawls law, they be called as an ideal solution. Whereas those solutions which does not obey Rawls law are called as a non-ideal solution. But all the solutions are not ideal in general conditions. To make ideal, we prefer to follow some rules. That is, the enthalpy of mixing delta mixed ice should be always zero. That means what? There is no change of heat. There is no change of heat during the dissolution process. Yes, generally dissolution process will have change in the heat. That is, delta ice mix is always greater than zero. But if you bring down the heat change up to zero, then there may be the chance to convert it into an ideal solution. Another point is delta V mix is always zero. That means there should not be any expansion or contraction of volume in the time of mixing. Then the solution we can say as Rawls law. Say there are some examples of those solutions which obey Rawls law, that is, which are of ideal solutions in some specific conditions. That is, the mixture of benzene and toluene can behave as an ideal solution. And the mixture of N-hexane and N-heptane can also behave as an ideal solution. The mixture of ethyl iodide and ethyl bromide can also behave as an ideal solution. Another example is the mixture of chlorobenzene and bromobenzene. The mixture of chlorobenzene and bromobenzene can also behave as an ideal solution. These are conditions for identity of a solution. So we can say, now ideal solution, ideal solution. When does an ideal solution become ideal? For that, we need to see the intermolecular force of attraction. So we can say the solution in which solute interaction. Now this portion of interactions you need to check by using your type of the chemical bond. So like this one. Interaction are almost similar to interactions and solvent. That is AA interactions. Interactions are almost similar to. Interaction. Now, if this is the condition, if this is the condition, then it can show ideal characters. Then the solution is called ideal solution. Ideal solution. In an ideal solution, delta number one, delta is index. We will discuss now. Delta is index is equal to zero. That means no energy is involved or absorbed. That is what no energy is involved or absorbed during the dissolution process. During the dissolution process. This is the first condition for ideal solution. And number two, delta V mix. Delta volume mixing is equal to zero. That means there is no change, expansion or contraction of volume, no expansion. Expansion or contraction. Contraction of volume. If the solution get these conditions, then it is called as an ideal solution. A pair of ideal solutions are, as which we have already discussed, benzene with toluene. Benzene with toluene. Examples of ideal solutions are, say, examples of ideal solutions are benzene plus toluene. Benzene plus toluene is the first example. So we can say again N-hexane plus N-heptane. N-hexane plus N-heptane. Heptane. This is the second example. The third example we can take is chlorobenzene and bromobenzene. Chlorobenzene and bromobenzene. Yes, these examples are very important for your examples, okay? So, ethyl iodide and ethyl bromide. Mixture of ethyl iodide and ethyl iodide plus ethyl bromide. All these mixtures can show ideal characters. Now, let us discuss about the non-ideal solution. Those solutions which does not obey Raoult's law, they are called as a non-ideal solution. So let us see non-ideal solution. Non-ideal solution. That means in the non-ideal solution, the interactions between AA, BB is highly different with the AB. Then it is called as a non-ideal solution. So we can say those solutions which does not obey Raoult's law are called non-ideal solutions. Solution first condition which we have is delta is mixing means does not equal to zero. That means there should be either absorption or evolution of heat. Then number two, delta V mix does not equal to zero. That means there should be either expansion or contraction of volume. Then if these conditions are applied, then it is called as a non-ideal solution. A non-ideal solutions can show either positive deviations or negative deviations of the values which you obtain from the ground slope. That means when you draw the graph, you may get either the values of the graph may increase or decrease from the original one which you get from the ground slope. And this is what if the graph move upward of that original one, then it is called as a positive deviation. Now let us see non-ideal solution showing positive deviation. Non-ideal solution showing positive deviation. Here we need to see if when does the positive deviation can source, when does negative deviation can source. All this depends on your intermolecular force of attraction. If AB interactions are weaker than, if AB interaction, if AB interactions are weaker than AA or AA or BB, and the observed vapor pressure of its component and the observed vapor pressure of its component and the total vapor pressure and the total vapor pressure and the total vapor pressure are greater than the predicted, are greater than the predicted by Ground slope. Predicted by Ground slope. Then it is called as a positive deviation. Now this is what about positive deviation. Now let us see a graph of positive deviation. In just things, yes, we have already noted here we need to draw vapor pressure. Now we have mole fraction. Here is the component 2, here is the component 1. Here component 1 become 1 and component 2 become 0. Mole fraction of this one. Here this is mole fraction x. Then we have here component 1 become 0, component 2 become 1 here in this case. So, in this, let us get this one, P1 and the P0 1, P0 2. Now, let us draw a graph. And let us draw a graph. This is called X1, gradually decreases. Then, the value of the vapor pressure gradually decreases. So X1 increase means gradually the value of vapor pressure gradually increases. So it is a P1. It is a P1. That is what now equation 1. This is of equation 1. Now this is of P2. That is what equation 2. This is the one which we have predicted by the. This is the one which we have predicted by the Raoult's law. But the actual one which we get after the combination of such solutions, that is one of such solutions showing positive deviations, we will get as this is the actual graph. Actual graph is as like this. Actual graph is as like this. This now this is the total graph. Actual graph. Actual. This is why the total graph. The total by round square. And this is P2, P2 gradually is like this one. This is actual P2, and this is round slope. Why? Rounds. And again, so all this round for one we can write as dotted diagonal so that you can easily understand. This dotted one shows round row. The third one shows round row. So this is here also we can have a dotted line. Now original one should be as like this. This is original. Actual. This is what? Actual. So look, actual. So we can say deep line is actual vapor. Actual vapor. Pressure. Whereas dotted line is vapor pressure predicted by rounds flow. So here when we compare these two, we know that here is an increase of value from this to this. Here is an increase of value from this to this. There is an increase in value from this to this. This is what we call as a positive deviations. Positive deviations. Such deviations take place in those mixtures which we already discussed. That is, now let us see those mixtures which have positive deviations. Let us find out some more examples of this. Now, examples of those which have positive deviation. Examples of those solutions which have positive deviations. That means this one, non-ideal solutions. Example, that is ethanol and water. This one. Number two, carbon disulfide and acetone. CH2 and acetone. This mixture also can show positive deviation. Next example we get the carbon tetrachloride plus our benzene C6H6. Carbon tetrachloride plus benzene can also show positive deviation. Carbon tetrachloride plus methyl benzene. Carbon tetrachloride plus C6H5CH3. Carbon tetrachloride plus methyl benzene. This also can show your positive deviation. Ethanol and cyclohexane. This mixture also can show positive deviation. And methanol and carbon tetrachloride CCl4 and CCl3. This carbon tetrachloride, this is chloroform. This is what? Chloroform. All these mixtures can show positive deviation. Now, let us go to the non-ideal solution showing negative deviation. Here, yes, we know that first one, AB interactions is weaker than AA or BB. And opposite of that, that is what? It will show negative deviations. So we can write as AB interaction. If AB interaction are stronger, if AB interactions are stronger than AA or BB interactions. BB interaction. A BB interaction. And observe vapor pressure of this component and observe vapor pressure of this component and the total vapor pressure and the total vapor pressure. Total vapor pressure are lesser than the predicted value by Rawls law. Then it is for negative deviation. Negative deviation. So here, let us see some examples of negative deviation along the graph. The first, same thing like the previous graph, which was drawn like this one. This is here x1 and x2 we have taken. x1 becomes 0 here in this case. And x2 become 1, and here x1 become 1, x2 become 0, and this is more person x. We need to go as well. Here we have vapor pressure. So the first P2 graph is as like this one. This is observed by the your cross, and this is observed by the Rawls law in P1, this is for P1, this is for P2. So here P0 1, this is the highest one. Here P0 2 is the highest one, 2. So this is for your P total. This total I chose P total. Now, if it is an non-ideal solution, showing negative deviation, then the value become as inverse. This is E total. This is what? E total equal to E1 plus E2. This is what we have. And this is this deep lines. This is for E2. This is for E2. And this is for E1. This is for P1. So here the actual value is decreased from the ideal behavior. And here also the actual value is decreased from the ideal behavior. Here also the decrease should be there from an ideal. This is the ideal conditions, ideal solutions. If it is an ideal, it should be means that if it can behave, it can follow Rawls law, then the value should be this. But actually what we put is down the predicted values from the this Rawls. So it is of negative deviation. Now this is what about the positive and negative deviation. Now these deviations can be exist in case of some solutions, that is water with nitric acid. Water plus HNO3, these are examples of water with HNO3, methanol plus acetic acid, This is mixture terms of negative deviation and your chloroform with acetone. Chloroform with acetone means CHCl3 plus CH3COCH3. And your chloroform with benzene, the chloroform with benzene and water with HCl, H2O plus HCl. This mixture shows negative deviation. So this is what about the positive and the negative deviation. Now let us discuss about the azeotropic mixture. Let us discuss about the azeotropic mixture. It is binary mixture only, but here you will have both the liquid phase as well as vapor phase have same vapor pressure and they will boil at the same temperature. So we have two solutions, that means a mixture of two solutions. You can say here is a azeotropic mixture, This is the point which we need to discuss. A mixture of two liquids. A mixture of two liquids which boil at a particular temperature, like pure metal or like pure liquids, and distill over say person which we have is of minimum boiling azeotropes. Number one, minimum boiling azeotropes. Minimum boiling azeotropes. This minimum boiling azeotropes are formed by those solutions which have negative deviations. Minimum boiling azeotropes are formed by those solutions. You can say they are formed by those solutions is related to non-iodine resource positive deviation. There is minimum are shown by the non-iodine solutions which have positive deviation. It's a positive deviation. And this azeotropes have boiled lower than either one of the coordinates. Azeotropes have boiling point gamma and either of the components. Means when you compare the boiling point of isotropic mixture and your pure components, isotropic mixtures always have lower boiling point than the pure components. Now let us take one example. Water. If you have the water, 4.43% of water. Of water by mass, and when combined with 95.57% of alcohol C2H5OH, then it reaches, if this composition is there, then it reaches the maximum isotropic components. That is what? So the minimum isotropic component. Mum boiling isotopes. Mum boiling isotopes. This mixture is the mixture of water research, the composition 4.43% and alcohol research 95.57%. Then this mixture always will have a minimum boiling isotropic mixtures, and that is why we cannot separate out alcohol from a solution of alcohol and water by distillation completely. At least with that is when the alcohol percentage reaches up to 95.57%, then both water and alcohol can evaporate it, and hence you never get pure alcohol. So this is what first type of isotopes. Next is maxima. Next, number two, maximum boiling isotopes. Maximum boiling isotopes. We will discuss about this one, maximum boiling isotopes. Here, number three. They are formed by those non-ideal solutions. Those non-ideal solutions which have negative deviation from the ideal behavior. Negative deviation. So this is what about this. If you have taken a mixture of here isotope, this means which is the maximum boiling isotopes have boiling point higher than. Here you need to go opposite, higher than either of the components. Now let us take one example. This example, water component should be 20.22. Water component should be 20.22% of water when it combined with 79.78% of HCl. Then you will get maximum body isotropes. This is about the isotropic mixture. Now we will go to the another properties. It is colligative properties of a solution. Now, colligative properties of a solution. will be discussed in the next class. Thank you.